I was at a loss until.
You're right. There's a lot more. Whoa, there's people back there. That's good. Goodness. Is it okay for me to point out that this is a lot more lively service than the first one? Man, people yelling. I'm just assuming more caffeine, more time to get up, to wake it. My family is back here in the corner. They may look like zombies because we all stayed in one hotel room last night, and it was a little bit smaller than we were expecting, and we were basically on top of each other. And I am highly caffeinated right now. It is so good to be with you. Okay, so I promised Mike I would tell one story about being confused for the Christian singer. Actually, I'm going to tell you two, short one and then another one. So when he first hit the scene, this was like late 90s, and I was in Lifeway in Birmingham. It was the big one right there when it was on Lakeshore. You remember that one? It was the biggest one around. And I was in there, and I walk in, and there's this stand-up of a guy, and he's kind of bent over like this, and he doesn't have a bald spot like I do now, but he looked, just like a normal guy with dark hair, and his name underneath it, really big, said Matt Redman, and I was like, what is going on here? I mean, I had to do a double take, because all of my Little League jerseys were spelled not M-O-N-D, they were M-A-N on the back, because nobody could ever spell my name correctly, so when I see it like that, it immediately set off alarm bells, and then I go to pay for something at the cash register, and the lady looks at my card and my account there, and she kind of looks at me and looks at my card, and I said, I'm not that guy over there. I'm not that guy. He's not in your store right now. So that was my first clue 20-plus years ago that this was going to be a problem. Little did I know that a number of years later, I would get a Facebook message from a lady telling me in broken English that they have just translated all of my songs into the Kiwi language for her tribe. Now, I want to ask you, how would you respond to that? Sorry, lady, you got the wrong guy. Or thank you for doing. Yeah, I didn't know what else to do. I didn't want to break her heart. You know, she said she was my biggest fan. So, I want to tell you another story about Mike. I told this to the first service. I'll tell it to you. When my wife and I, a number of years ago, were visiting a church where he was on staff, which is also where my father-in-law was on staff, and it was in our neighborhood, and Mike preached that Sunday, and I remember telling my wife afterwards, I remember saying, if they hired Mike to preach, I would, we would be here. So I know you already know that. I know that you are aware of his gifts and his heart. Okay, so this morning, I feel like it's my job to encourage you this morning. That's what I would long to do. I'm going to go ahead and get you to, actually wait just a moment. I want you to hear something. And this is actually from Mike too. He posted this on Facebook the other day, and I was like, oh man, this is perfect. I'm going to thank you for preparing my sermon for me. This is a quote from a book called The Relentless Encourager. Is that right? Y'all may have seen him post this. Mike is also one of those guys that when he posts something, I pay attention to it. I hide a lot of people. But I do pay attention to him. This is a quote from that book, and it's really where my heart is this morning, because my assumption is, in all seriousness, that in a crowd this size, there's going to be some discouraged people. Some people that are hurting for one reason or another. I have a heart for people who are hurting in especially vocational areas of anxiety. That's one of the 90% of the people I counsel are dealing with anxiety. And so let me read you this quote about encouragement. Regardless of the, quote, front some people put up, making it seem like all is well and that they have it all together, many people are incredibly discouraged. Doesn't that sound like a Facebook post? Everybody having it all together. And because of this, in a world where we are daily bombarded with so many discouraging words, the Lord calls us to shine light into the lives of others through intentional encouragement. This kind of intentional encouragement brings hope to those who are discouraged and feeling hopeless. It brings hope in the Lord. It brings hope in his goodness and in his power. It brings hope that he is alive and at work in amazing ways, bringing about much good in what often feels like a dark and discouraging world. So my hope this morning is to encourage you as we talk about this passage. So if you would, go ahead and turn your Bibles to Ecclesiastes 9. We're going to be looking at verses 1 through 10. I'm going to read all of those. We'll focus in mainly on verses 7 through 10. While you're turning there, I want to tell you about an assumption I have, and which is, this assumption is kind of foundational. I want to make sure you understand that I speak to you as one who believes that we have a king and a kingdom. We have a king who has the song we just sang, and that, by the way, that was beautiful hearing your voices behind me. We have a king who has defeated our great enemies of sin and death. It is easy to function in this world and to buy into the idea that our enemies are things that we can see, like maybe the media or the government or someone who disagrees with us politically or who is part of an organization we don't agree with. But our great enemies of sin and death, those powers of darkness, those are our enemies, and we have been assured of their defeat. And because of that, because of the work that the King has done on the cross, we have experienced forgiveness of our sins. We have been justified, and we can now live before God just as if I'd never sinned and just as if I had done all that was required of me in the law, because we have the righteousness of Christ credited to us. And so we're safe, right? We're safe from those enemies. So we have a king. But we also have a kingdom that we reside in through our confidence in Jesus as our leader and our teacher. In other words, we as his disciples step behind him, and when he says, as those who are the redeemed, love your enemies, we look and we go, good, yes, I will do this because this is the path towards life. And so that is foundational. So this is what I'm saying is not substitute for any of that, but that is the kind of people that we are living out what we're going to talk about this morning that Solomon says. We are the redeemed citizens of an unshakable kingdom. And we have a king who loves us and cares for us right where we are. All right, I'm going to read Ecclesiastes 9, 1 through 10. If you would please read along with me God's word. But all this I laid to heart, examining it all, how the righteous and the wise and their deeds are in the hand of God. Whether it is love or hate, man does not know. Both are before him. It is the same for all, since the same event happens to the righteous and the wicked, to the good and the evil, to the clean and the unclean, to him who sacrifices and him who does not sacrifice. As the good one is, so is the sinner, and he who swears is as he who shuns an oath. This is an evil in all that is done under the sun, that the same event happens to all. Also, the hearts of the children of man are full of evil, and madness is in their hearts while they live, and after that they go to the dead. But he who is joined with the living has hope, for a living dog is better than a dead lion. For the living know that they will die, but the dead know nothing, and they have no more reward, for the memory of them is forgotten. Their love and their hate and their envy have already perished, and forever they have no more share in all that is done under the sun. And this is what we're going to focus on this morning. Go, eat your bread with joy. Drink your wine with a merry heart, for God has already approved what you do. Let your garments be always white. Let not oil be lacking on your head. Enjoy life with the wife whom you love all the days of your vain life that he has given you under the sun, because that is your portion in life and in your toil at which you toil under the sun. Whatever your hand finds to do, do it with your might, for there is no work or thought or knowledge or wisdom in Sheol to which you are going. Let me pray for us before we dive in. Father, we come to you thankful for your word. Thankful that we have wisdom that we can pick up and turn to. We have such easy access to it these days. I pray that we would love it, and that we would feed on it as strong drink and good meat. That it would be beautiful in our eyes and would sustain us when the world leaves us hungry. And Father, we thank you for your word made flesh, Jesus, the King. We thank you for his defeat of sin and death, our great enemies. And we thank you that he has made us citizens of an unshakable kingdom, a kingdom of love and joy and peace. We ask all this in the name of the King. Amen. I love the book of Ecclesiastes because it's weird. It is a weird, weird book, right? It is not one, it's not, you can't just look at it straight. You gotta, and just walk away from it. You've got to spend time with it. It makes you think differently than, say, Jesus, you know, talking to his disciples, or Paul in Romans 8, or John, you know, telling us to love everyone, and everyone who does not love doesn't know the Father, and things like that. I mean, those are pretty straightforward. Ecclesiastes, you read it, and if you're, and you've got to, even if you're reading it right, you're scratching your head half the time. You've probably been doing that for however long you've been studying it, right? I also love it because when I was doing youth ministry in Wichita, I also had to do, I was tasked with, oh yeah, also we want you to build a college and career / singles ministry, and we have four right now. And we want you to build this, okay, in your free time when you're not doing middle school and high school ministry with hundreds of kids and lots of volunteers. So I did. I told them, I said, okay, well, I want to take it. We were in the suburbs, so I said, I'm going to take it downtown to a coffee shop. We're going to meet in the back, and we're going to talk about Ecclesiastes. And they did not like that idea. My leadership thought that was a terrible idea. And but that's what we did, and it is that group actually became a church out of that study. And they loved it, and I loved teaching it because it made them, most of them, people who had grown up in the church, think so differently about the world that they live in, the God that they worshiped, and who they were before them. And so I love it. I want to give you two kind of basic observations about, first of all, 7 through 10. Okay, so if you want to look at 7 through 10 there, look at these. We have four verses here and kind of four things that we're called to do here by Solomon, right? The first one is go eat your bread and drink your wine with a merry heart, okay? Second one is let your garments be always white. Let not oil be lacking on your head. Now, this isn't about necessarily keeping your clothes clean, although I would love for my children to hear this, and I may need to hear it too. You can probably understand, but that's not what it's about. All of the commentators basically say that this is a picture of festal joy. Festival. The idea of these are pictures of enjoying gifts and the goodness of God that he gives us, okay? And so in other words, when we enjoy something like the ribs I had, which, by the way, it was the last slab of baby back ribs at Rib Country last night. It was the last one, and it was so delicious. I just walked around to all the other tables and just showed them. I was like, these are the last ones. They're so good. I'm sorry you didn't get any. I'm just kidding. I would never do that to people I didn't know, only to people I know. And but when we enjoy things like that, that's what this picture is right here, right? Man, they were good. Third thing, enjoy life with the wife whom you love. And if you have a spouse, enjoy your time with them. Enjoy them as a person in all of their personhood, and all of the things that they love that maybe you don't love. I do a lot of counseling about that, by the way. I have a guy right now who is more obsessed with Lord of the Rings than I am, and that's a lot. And his wife has no tolerance for that. We're working through it, though. We're working through it. I'm not going to tell you whose side I'm taking. Fourth thing, whatever your hand finds to do, do it with your might. So the idea is work hard. Whatever work that you've been given to do in this world, work at it. Now, there's two things I want you to see about these four things, okay? First one is, all of these very basic, ordinary, mundane things that are just part of regular life, right? It's not go do something big, go do something exciting, go do something amazing. It is basically do these four things that probably everybody in this room, if you're married, you're probably seeking to do this or doing this. Or you know you should be doing this, right? That's the first thing. Very everyday things. Second thing, that doesn't mean they don't matter. Oftentimes, we buy into the idea that the things that matter are the things that get our attention the most. And therefore, we buy into the people that matter are the ones that get our attention the most. And the things that matter, and the places that matter, and all those things, that's what matters. Let me get you to do something so you can see how much this matters. Imagine the opposite of these four things. Imagine not enjoying the food that's been provided for you. In other words, you could imagine me when I was about 7 years old and my mom would serve meatloaf. Imagine being fed and refusing to enjoy it. Imagine not seeing the gifts around you and the goodness that God has provided you and not enjoying them. What if last night I had refused to enjoy the ribs because they were out of brisket? You know, some of you were kind of smiling, but the fact is, we do that a lot. We refuse to enjoy the gifts that we have because of the things that we don't have. I mean, we all do this. Imagine not a home where spouses do not enjoy the life they have with one another. You don't have to imagine it. You've probably seen it somewhere. And then imagine work that is not done well or with any kind of desire to do well or with all your might, just kind of half-heartedly doing it. That's when you know that it matters, when these things are absent. If you stop and think about each of these also, each of these instructions reflect the character of God. So, if you think about eating, by the way, I remember years ago, some of you, I'm pushing 50, and I remember when Facebook, you know, now, everybody's always talking about politics all the time, that when somebody posts like a picture of what they had for lunch, it's like really refreshing, right? But that used to be kind of weird. You remember when that was kind of weird? It's kind of odd. Like people would be like, oh, that's a good looking cheeseburger. Why are you taking a picture of it? But now that's normal. Now, here's the thing. Our enjoyment of food should be one of the most natural things in this world. It is the thing that has been given to us to sustain us so that we can do everything else. And it is, and not only was it, I mean, God could have given it to us in a way in which it tasted like cardboard. Kind of like the, we do communion now, and we use that, y'all are laughing, are y'all using those? The cup, and it tastes like cardboard. It's like cardboard and Robitussin. It's so bad. That's actually a good illustration. It's actually a really good illustration because God has given us something far. I mean, He's given us taste buds so that we would enjoy good food. And I think that there should be a straight line between us being thankful for our food and glad that it tastes good and that we have it, and our recognition of who God is in his goodness. And yet it's something that we do all the time, three times a day at least. If you're more, four or five. If you're like me, you know. Second, joy is a fundamental characteristic of God. So that let your garments, that festal joy, think about this. Joy is, now again, I'm not, to quote Bob Dylan, happy is a yuppie word. But when I mean joy, I mean deep satisfaction. That in the midst of possible suffering, but that suffering cannot take away. And we know that joy is a reflection of God because Jesus himself, for the joy set before him, endured the cross. We were created to be joyful people. Next, enjoying life with our spouse is a reflection of, I think, obviously Christ in the church. Paul talks about this in Ephesians, right? You know, Christ is the groom, and we as the church are the bride, and that's a picture. A marriage is a picture of the relationship with Christ and his people, and that's beautiful. But I think it also goes even further back into the Trinity, into all the Godhead has been in joyful, loving relationship with one another for all eternity. And when we love our spouses and we love our life with our spouses, we reflect that eternity of relational existence that has always been there. And then work is a fundamental part of our humanity. Work was before the fall. One of the most helpful things that I tell my clients when I'm counseling them, especially true for men, I found, could be just because I counsel men more, but is when I tell them in the midst of their vocational frustrations that it makes sense for them to have vocational frustrations because work and vocation is a part of them as a person. It's an important part of who they are as a person. And I can just see them relax. They're like, okay, this makes sense. If I feel unfulfilled or if I feel like I'm struggling in my vocation, it makes sense because this is a huge part of how God has made me to enjoy my work and to have some kind of fulfillment in it. All of these reflect back to God and out into world our humanity and the fact that we are created in the image of God. So, when we joyfully and contentedly live our ordinary lives as followers of Jesus, we do something that is extremely important, and we can see this in Ecclesiastes really well. We push back against the fall. We push back against our enemies. Very plainly in Ecclesiastes, the enemy of death. I mean, death is everywhere in Ecclesiastes. I'm sure you've realized this now. It's kind of like, you know, you read and like, here's something really good, but you're going to die anyway. And here's something really cool. You know, Solomon's like, this is great. Look at this. Oh, but you're going to die anyway. I mean, it's constant. It is constant throughout Ecclesiastes. And it's really the backdrop for this passage. And when we enjoy these things, this part of life, these small everyday parts of life, when we are joyfully and contentedly living this out as followers of Jesus, we push back against death itself. Because the opposite would be to not be able to enjoy them because you've looked down into the well of life and there's nothing there. But for us believers, there is something there. And that's why I wrote The God of the Mundane. I wanted to encourage small people working in small places, doing small things. I wanted these Christians to know that they can follow Jesus right where they are. And I wanted people to clearly hear that it all matters, even the everyday stuff. Now, let me say something really clear here, because I wrote this book a number of years ago. Second edition just came out recently. And every now and then people will ask me or they'll kind of push back and they feel like I am making it sound like missions is not a big deal or that we shouldn't consider missions. And that's the last thing that I would be saying. I read mission biographies on a regular basis. I just forced my kids, my homeschooling kids, to read a bunch of missionary biographies as part of their Bible curriculum this past year. We love missions. I believe in missions. What I don't believe in is a love or thinking about missions as the only place where God can do amazing things and where God is working. I read a quote, it's actually a quote by Dante in another book, and I want you to hear it. "The glory of the one who moves all things permeates the universe and glows. In every crack, in every crevice of our lives, whether it's just at the table, in the den, in the kitchen, the yard, wherever, the glory of the one who moves everything." In other words, who's in control of everything. And if anything happens, he's the mover. Permeates every part of this universe, and it makes it glow. Let me tell you how it started. Hopefully this will encourage you as I tell you how it started for me to write a book about the God of the mundane. Well, it all started with a blog post. And this was years ago. I started writing a blog post for a blog back in the 2008, 2009. And I would get so excited if five people from Kazakhstan read what I wrote. I mean, I would just get so excited. And you know, I mean, because I was a nobody. I mean, nobody was reading what I was writing except for maybe my wife and my mom and people in Kazakhstan. I'm not kidding. And not sure how I got big there, those three people. And then about 2010, I wrote a blog post called The God of the Mundane, which is the title of the book where it came from. And that one went actually viral. And I can't even remember how that happened. I don't know who got a hold of it, but it ended up going and being read by tens of thousands of people. And it really started from this. It started from a conversation, a few different things, but the first thing was a conversation my wife had with a friend of hers. This friend was homeschooling her four children, and was her husband was working three jobs to make ends meet. And this friend said to my wife, said, "I just don't feel like I'm doing enough for the kingdom." I know it's funny because it's kind of a. Are you kidding? You're homeschooling your four children. Your wife is working. You know, you're discipling your children every day, and your wife. So, and your husband is working these three to four jobs, so you can do this. So that was the first thing that got me thinking. Second thing, I had talked to a number of people, young and old, but mainly young people who were dealing with missions guilt. That if they don't. There was kind of a guilty feeling about not wanting to go overseas and do missions. I actually had a former student who told me he felt guilty because he wanted to go study medicine instead of go do youth ministry like I did when I was his youth pastor. And I told him, no need to feel guilty about that. But I was having this conversation again and again. And then I was working in a church when I wrote this, and it was, for lack of a better term, the best way to explain it was a hipster church. Okay, lots of skinny jeans, nothing wrong with this. Lots of skinny jeans, lots of beard oil, lots of soy lattes in church on Sunday morning, met downtown. We had they had a heart for missions, and they wanted to go overseas and do missions for a week or 10 days or 2 weeks, and they wanted to raise money. But we were struggling to get people in the nursery. And so I told him, I said, "I'm not giving you any money until you go work in the nursery." A Fourth thing, this may embarrass my wife who is in the crowd, but I was seeing my own wife's version of mom guilt. I see a couple moms nodding their head and smiling. They know what I'm talking about. You've seen the mom guilt of looking at the fabulous lives of other families on social media and wondering if you're doing enough, wondering if you're discipling your kids enough, wondering if you're doing the right vacations, wondering if you're doing the right things, you know, before bedtime, wondering if you're doing the right things when they first wake up. Should you homeschool? Should you not? Should you put them in Christian school? Should you? And so mom guilt. And then my own self, I was in a small church as a pastor, and I was worried. You know, I would have these thoughts about, you know, wanting to do something big that people would take notice of. And so that was a struggle. So that's how it all started. That's where that post and then many other posts that became a book started. Let's talk about who this book was for. So my publisher said, when you start writing, I want you to visualize an audience, okay? Who is your audience? Who are you writing to? So I thought of three people. These were the three images. The first image is kind of borrowed from a friend of ours, kind of an amalgamation, but really borrowed from a friend of ours. And it was a homemaker, stay-at-home mom, who was frustrated about, once again, having to scrape up the macaroni and cheese from the night before off the floor in the kitchen. She's on her knees trying to get it up, and she can't get it up. She's just frustrated at what she has to do day in and day out. That was the first person. Second person was a teller at a bank. When I thought about this, I had never been a teller, I didn't even know one, I don't think. But it seemed like a really frustrating job to me, mainly because I can't do math. And so that seemed really frustrating that you had to count things and you had to balance this drawer. And so that seemed really frustrating to do. And let me warn you, if you write a book called The God of the Mundane and you picture a teller in your head and you are trying to minister to that person with this message, God just might make you that. The church that we were a part of went through a hard time. We got them through that hard time, and then we had to take a break. My dad was very sick, and we decided to step away from ministry but stay in Birmingham. And I know this may be hard to believe, but facility with Greek and Hebrew does not qualify you for very many well-paying jobs. And so I was struggling to find a job, and I finally ran into a friend of mine from college who was working for a bank, and he said, hey, if you get really desperate, call me. And so I called him eventually, and I said, hey, I'm desperate. And he said, okay, we'll put you, you know, in a branch. And I was a loan officer, and I will never forget one day they said, hey, we need to train you to be a fill-in for a teller. I don't know why you're laughing, because it was not funny. I had a woman who was a customer of mine, and I was trying to help her one day. I was about 6 months into being working at the bank, and here I am. I am the least likely person to enjoy wearing a coat and a tie, and I'm sitting there wearing a coat and a tie and wingtip shoes, And I'm trying to help this lady, and I said, hey, I need to go ask my manager a question. I'm not really sure how to handle this at this point. She's like, she kind of looked at me. I said, I'm sorry, I've only been here like 6-7 months. And she's like, well, what did you do before that? I was like, well, I was a pastor. She said, you need to go back to doing that. I was, for many years, the worst banker you have ever met, and probably still so. So again, here I was, not kidding, writing a book, having a picture in my head of a teller, and I end up being one sometimes, having to count. Last person to learn long division in fourth grade, and I'm having to make sure these things balance, these drawers balance, and I could not do it most of the time. It was terrible. And the good thing is when you do a bad job, they don't ask you to do it as much. The last group that I had in mind was pastors, and one reason why is because I was one when I was writing the book. the book came out, by the time the book came out, I was working in a bank. I'm going to tell the story. I almost forgot. While I'm working at the bank, I get a college student who comes in, sits down with me, and by the way, I mean, you need to know, if you've ever been miserable in a job, I mean, soul-sucking misery. It is funny. Now. But it was so bad that it was actually a lyric from a song, but I had this word constantly in my head, and it was just the word defeat. And it was like every single day. It was so dark, I try not to even think about it. Because I was literally always in trouble at work because I wasn't doing what I was supposed to do very well. This woman comes in one day, a young woman, she's a college student, she sits down, and I can tell, I have radar for this, and by the time, you know, because I've been the pastor, they send all the crying customers to me, and so this one comes, and I can tell she's like on the verge, and she's sitting down in front of me, and she says, hey, I need to talk to you about my bank account. That usually means that they've overdrawn, and I knew that, I could tell by the way she said it. So I pull up her account and we're talking about it, and she just burst into tears and she says, I've just lost my cheerleading scholarship because of having to get treated for cancer. And so it's even kind of hard to talk about now, but she didn't have any money at that time. And so I broke all the rules and prayed for her right then and there. And we talked a little bit, and I talked about some possible solutions for her, and she went on her way, and that was a really hard day for her, for me too, but in many ways, I felt more comfortable doing that than anything. She comes back, I can't remember how long later, maybe a couple weeks later, I don't know, she comes back and she tells me that they have decided to reinstate her scholarship. And that put her in a place where she had some extra money. She could stay in school. They were working with her about all this. That's the only reason why she came in, was to tell me this. And I tell you that story so that you will see that even in the midst of all that defeat that I felt like I was experiencing, I got to experience this beautiful picture of me just doing my job and somebody coming in and getting a reflection of that glory that permeates the universe and glows. So what did I see in the scriptures? As soon as I started thinking along these lines, by the way, when I wrote this blog post, it was totally off the cuff. It wasn't like something I'd spent a lot of time on. It was like 500 words off the cuff, not even hardly trying to do anything. But the more I started thinking about this, the more I started seeing this is everywhere in the scriptures. This idea that God works in the ordinary and that he wants us to be faithful right where we are, and we don't have to think about having leading exciting lives and doing big things, that there are no small places, no small people, no small things. It was everywhere, and I had just missed it pretty much my whole life. Let me give you a couple of examples. This was the first thing. Now, this may show how clueless I am. I don't know. Maybe you have seen this. I had functioned for so long without realizing that when Paul is talking to the churches, when he's writing to the churches, he never says, I want you to plant churches like me. I want you to leave your job as the butcher, baker, candlestick maker, whatever it is you are, doctor, lawyer, whatever. He never says that. He basically says, I want you to be a follower of Jesus and believe this gospel and have confidence in it and know that you are a citizen of the kingdom right where you are. I had never noticed this before. I had just assumed that if I was a pastor, everybody should long to do what I did. not realizing that living out the faith wherever they were, whether they're in a job, or in school, college, wherever, at home, I just totally missed it. I did not realize that the person in the pew was the recipient and they were to stay there and be faithful right where they were. Second thing, all of the things that the New Testament writers ask us to do are pretty ordinary things. They're just everyday. I mean, they can be done everywhere you are. You don't have to move to do them. You don't have to move to put away malice and anger and slander and filthy language and to put on, as Paul says in Colossians 3, compassion and kindness, humility, gentleness, patience. All those things can be done wherever you are. And if you do them wherever you are, people will notice. Third thing. Jesus says to his disciples, he says, whoever gives one of my disciples a cup of cold water in my name will be blessed. A cup of cold water. That's a pretty small thing. I have thought about that statement for so many years because our culture trains us to think that such a small thing is inconsequential. I think we live in a culture which of protest and political activism at the expense of daily small acts of kindness. I honestly believe that if the church wants to change the world, that's how it happens. Not necessarily a cup of cold water, but sometimes it's just a smile. Sometimes it's just a kind, encouraging word. So let me tell you, before I close, let me remind you, the whole reason for this, and I think what Solomon is trying to get us to see here, he's basically saying no small thing. These are not small things. These are important things. But also, no small places. So if you're working in a place that seems almost forgotten and obscure, no small places. Maybe you're working as a pastor in a mountain town. No small places. Maybe you're working in a cubicle and people basically forget that you're even there some days. But certainly no small people. We live in a culture of where we are, I mean, think about how much our culture is celebrity driven. I mean, it is constant, and you probably haven't ever stopped to think about the effect that it has on you. Most people have not. And when you live in a culture that is celebrity driven, it's going to be hard to buy into the idea that small people matter. It all matters to God. There's a story in a Mark Helpern book, a small, short story I'll tell you quickly. He says, it's a story called Martin Breyer, and there's this younger brother and this older sister. The older sister is at that teenage age where she just wants to get boys' attention. That's all she cares about, really, and go into parties and things like that. This is pre-World War II, between World War I and World War II. And they're in this, they're on vacation, and all she's bored because she wants to get out and everything. And Martin, the little boy, her little brother, builds something so that he can find out which way the wind is blowing. And he puts a something to make a sound so that when he lays in his bed at night, he knows which way the wind is blowing. And his sister goes, "Why would you do that?" He's like, "Well, I want to know which way the wind's blowing." She's like, "Why would that matter?" And he goes, "It matters. What I want you to hear is it all matters. Because the one who moves all things permeates the universe and glows." Let me give you one last thing. This is a reading from chapter 2 of the book where I answer if there is a God of the mundane, of ordinary things and ordinary places. Yes, there is a God for those who are not changing anything but diapers. There is a God for those who simply love their spouse and pour out unappreciated affection on their children day after day. There is a God for the mom who spends her days scraping the trampled mac and cheese off the kitchen floor. There is a God for the man who hammers out a day's work in obscurity for his wife and kids. There is a God for the just and kind employers. There is a God for generous homemakers. There is a God for day laborers looking at a missions trip to the far corners of the world like an unimaginable vacation. There is a God for the middle class people staving off cancer, struggling to raise teenagers, and simply hoping against hope they keep their jobs. There is a God for the broken home with a full bank account but an empty bed. There is a God for those children tending to the health of their aged parents. There is a God delighting in the ordinary existence of the unknown faithful doing unknown work. There is a God of grace for those who live out their faith everywhere but do not want to move anywhere. And there is even a God for those who have bigger homes, more money, nicer cars, and better health than me. And yes, there is a God of the mundane parts of life, the small moments. There is a God of kind smiles, good tips, and good mornings. There is a God of goodbye hugs and parting kisses, a God of firm handshakes, a God of grasping frail fingers in hospital rooms. There is a God of all the forgettable moments between the sensational and the never remembered. These are not spiritually vacuous moments for which there is no God. There is a God for those pastors who while away in mundane work, for those whose days turn into weeks, months, years, only distinguished by the need for a new calendar. There is a God for the mundane moments of ministry. There is a God for those with mundane lives. There is a God who can make sense of the life lived between the seismic and the extraordinary, between the joy and the pain. Yes, there is a God for the mean times in a culture drunk on the weekend's promises. This is an encouraging answer. Encouraging because most of us live very mundane lives. Encouraging because so much of our life is full of the mundane. The glory of the one who moves all things permeates the universe and glows. Let me pray for you.
I was at a loss until you found me. You gave me a home within your love. I was running blind. And